So today I'll be talking about an introduction to literature search. Now, obviously, much of the technical detail will be shared with you a little later by the subsequent speakers. So I'll be giving you only a brief introduction. Now, obviously, when I'm giving a brief introduction, my target is the beginner. So some of you may be the expert in this area. For them, it will look quite flat, but still I tell you, it is good to recapitulate everything again and again. So my presentation will be largely for the beginner. Now, this is the point to ponder. When we were doing DM, maybe about 25 or 28 years ago in SGCTR. Somebody not muted, yes. In SGCTR, please mute yourself. So what you used to do is that we used to go to the library to know all the literature. And I tell you that library in SGCTR was very new then. It was worth going to library. It was very interesting. Will not. Therefore, we'll go all the way to King George Medical College in the city. We'll go all the way to King George Medical College in the city. And then we'll really hunt for those journals full of dust and then queue up for photocopying. Queue up for photocopying. It was difficult. And then you have to retain all those knowledge, what you acquire by doing the literature search, using the hard copies of the journal and the books, you have to store them in your brain. Again, difficult, you tend to forget. But nowadays, everything comes on one click of a button and you actually put everything in your hard disk, okay? Maybe sometime when the storage capacity is exceeded, you increase the size of the hard disk. And the moment you want to know anything, let us say dose of a drug, evidence for treatment of a disease, you really just click on or hook on to your mobile. So really the things have changed in front of our eyes. And I tell you, we hardly ever visit library nowadays for seeing those hard copies of the journal and the books. These are all electronic in a small device. Now, therefore there is no denial by anybody, I suppose, that this technologies of literature search is very, very important. Because those old days have now gone. We do not really look for all those hard copies of the journal and the book or printed copies of the journal and the books. We want these to be electronic, available in our device, such as mobile, tab, or. Now, today, what is going to happen is in the next few session or next few presentation, you are going to be acquainted with the techniques of literature search, but I'm going to give you only an introduction. Now, so why should I know about all this literature search? Because you have to acquire the most recent knowledge, and this most recent knowledge is unexpected to be available in the books, because today, the edition of the book that is getting published, maybe all the authors have compiled all these about 3 years ago. And even when these are compiled by the publisher from the author might have written around 1 to 2 years ago. That basically means that if you today get the most recent edition of the book, the knowledge is about 5 years old. Therefore, the most current knowledge is required not only by the researcher, but for those who are going to give clinical care to the patient, and for those who are preparing presentations such as seminar, short topic in their department, and so on. For research, it is again required. for preparing review article for those who are doing MD thesis. In DM, typically, we don't need thesis, at least in SGPGI. Later, when you become a young faculty member, you require these for writing grants. You require these for preparing original article and meta-analysis. So therefore, there is no doubt you need to do literature search. Now, what are these search engines? There are a lot of search engines, but I have listed here the most popular one, such as PubMed, Google, Google Scholar, Scopus, Embase, and so on. Some of these are free. For example, PubMed, Google, Google Scholar is free, whereas others are paid, such as Scopus, Embase, etc. Now, all these are going to be spoken to you in detail, including the technique, how to use this search engine. So what is PubMed? PubMed is NLM's bibliographic database. So what is NLM? NLM is National Library of Medicine. So this is located in US. So they compile all the data, all the published data from all over the world, and then make it available for the whole world rather than restricting it to the US alone. It covers medicine, nursing, dentistry, veterinary medicine, healthcare system, preclinical sciences, and some other areas of life science. Also, why are you talking about all this? If you are going to look for an article in engineering science, don't search PubMed. For example, you want to know techniques of artificial intelligence described in an engineering science journal. If you do a PubMed search, you will not get it. It contains bibliographic citation and author abstract from 5,000 journals published from more than 70 countries. Obviously, the data records are much bigger now, but 1966, there were more than 16 million records. Each country is assigned a unique PMID. Now, see, why do you need to know this? Like, we get most of these in the books. Let us say now we know that coronavirus pandemic is happening. And you want to know, does chloroquine work? Does hydroxychloroquine work? Problem is, go to books. These are not yet written in most of the books, because the pandemic started just maybe in the end of 2019. Don't expect that in November 2020, there are all the books which underwent edition and then these are published. So therefore, what you do is you have to depend on electronic search engine. So here I've given an example. This is PubMed, and there I have written COVID-19 and gastrointestinal symptom. Obviously, here I've not written chloroquine. I've written COVID-19 and gastrointestinal symptoms. Why did I do that? Because what happens is we know now that COVID-19 patient, as much as 10 to 20% of them can have GI symptom, such as diarrhea, vomiting, abdominal pain, anorexia, nausea, and so on. Now, what people found is those who have GI symptom are more likely to have more severe disease and fatal disease than those who don't have GI symptoms. So therefore, what I did is I wrote in the PubMed COVID-19 and GI symptom. And let us say I got huge number of hit there, maybe more than 1,000. Now, let us say I'm interested to read one of these articles. And the moment I go there, this is an article published in a medicine journal called Annals of Internal Medicine. So basically, it is asking for payment. And each article you have to pay somewhere $30 or $40. So difficult to read an article, you have to pay $30 or $40. And many a time, everything may not be available in the library because of delay in subscription of journals in our library. So nowadays, science has become quite open. Look at it, what I did. I went to this search engine. This is called Sci-Hub. So what this Sci-Hub did is, they wanted science to be open. It is an issue which there could be some people who can debate. They may say it is not fair. Other side may say it is not unfair, but I am not taking any side. I am just showing you the technology. So what we do is that, take this number. This is called Digital Object Identifier, or DOI. Look at the DOI. It says 10.1016/site-new and so on. Now just copy this digital object identifier and put here in the Sci-Hub. Look at this. The moment you put it here, actually the article, the full text version become open. You can download and read it free of cost. Obviously, journal houses will say that this lady here, shown here, is spoiling all our business, because the journal houses or publisher were earning money by selling those articles. On the other hand, some of the author would say, I did all the hard work. I did the study. I analyzed the data. I wrote the paper. And now I gave to the journal for publication. They did little bit typesetting and peer reviewing. Now they are selling that article and authors doesn't get any penny out of it. So obviously, that whether it is right or wrong is an issue which can be debated. But for us, the researcher, it is a good option. And in fact, I know some of the publishing house tried in the court of law to actually stop it, but they could not. So this is another way of open access and the search engine. So when you are preparing a review article or thesis, what do? You really select a topic first. Then you search the literature. Then you develop the argument that why should I work on this issue? If the literature is plenty now, if I work on this issue, is it worth working? So you develop the argument that is it worth working? Is it something very new? Then again, you resurvey the literature. Are you missing something? Then after doing all this, you critique the literature and you see, is there something which is a lacuna in the literature? And can I write a review of the whole available literature and highlight the lacuna, which will be an original idea and many journals would publish the review, or you will be successful in writing the thesis. So this is what we'll be doing when we are writing a thesis, we are writing an original article, we are writing a review article, or we are writing a research grant. Therefore, literature search is essential before starting a research study. Why? Because you have to find out what has already been done so that you know this has been done, this has not been done. So therefore, if I plan to do this, this will be something new. You will know what method did the previous worker use. Because if you know what method the previous worker used, you will tend to follow the same path. You will also like to know what are the problems that the previous worker faced, so that while you plan the study, you will obviate all these problems, or try to obviate all these problems. You will have to reference the background information, because otherwise you cannot impress upon your peer reviewer or the grant giving authority why they should spend money on your project. You have to point out the gap in the current scientific knowledge, and you have to state how this study would bridge the gap in the knowledge. It basically means the literature search is key to the success in all this. Now, how do you do the literature search? You just don't blindly write anything and everything. You have to use keyword to actually do a literature search. So what are these keywords? keywords are called medical subject heading words or MESH word. Therefore, if you just use any and every sentence or word in the PubMed, that is not a fair way of searching literature. You should go to this medical subject heading book, which in our time used to be a printed copy only, but now you can go to MESH electronically and choose the word from there. For example, if you are doing COVID-19, now if the medical subject heading doesn't say COVID, it is better to say COVID-19 rather than COVID. You understand? So that is what you have to do. Sorry, 1 minute. Hello? मैं क्लास ले रहा हूँ थोड़ी देर में ठीक कॉल क्लास ले नाउ देन व्हाट यू डू इज दैट यू टॉक अबाउट द मेडिकल सब्जेक्ट हेडिंग एंड यूज दोज हेडिंग्स ओनली इफ यू रीड एनी आर्टिकल व्हाट द आर्टिकल डज इज आर्टिकल राइट्स अ टाइटल बट यू विल सी बिलो द एब्स्ट्रैक्ट इट राइट्स लॉट ऑफ कीवर्ड्स These keywords article write from the medical subject heading words. Why does it write that? It writes that because it wants that whenever somebody puts those words in the PubMed or any other search engine, this article should be captured by that search. So that's why you use keywords and the medical subject heading words. But let us say if I write, let us say hydroxychloroquine, I'm interested in hydroxychloroquine. That does hydroxychloroquine work in COVID-19? Now the problem is if I write hydroxychloroquine, lot of articles will come. It will come in relation to maybe malaria. It will come maybe in relation to rheumatoid arthritis and many autoimmune diseases. It will come in relation to COVID-19. Now let us say we get 20,000 hit, and out of this 20,000 hit, I have to search to find out which are COVID-19 related. Now you will say, no, sir, you just write hydroxychloroquine in COVID-19. What will happen is the moment you write that, you'll get thousands of articles on hydroxychloroquine, another maybe 10,000 articles on COVID-19. So you now got 11,000 from which you have to search. That's why what we use is called Boolean operator. What is Boolean operator? Boolean operator is if I write hydroxychloroquine and then write capital and, A-N-D, all in capital, then COVID-19, it will give all articles which relate to COVID-19 and hydroxychloroquine. If I write hydroxychloroquine, capital OR means or COVID-19, it will give everything which either has hydroxychloroquine or has COVID-19. But if I write hydroxychloroquine, not COVID-19, not capital, N-O-T, then it will give all the things related to hydroxychloroquine, excluding COVID-19. So this is called Boolean operator. It is one of the method for electronic search. I wanted to just introduce you to this, but obviously, I suppose my next speaker is going to show you how Boolean operator works. Now let us go to another search engine. Though PubMed is the most popular search engine by the medical scientists, but obviously there is a whole session I heard from Dr. Preeti on PubMed. So therefore, let us go to other search engine. For example, Google and Google Scholar. Google is www.google.com or google.co or .in. Google Scholar is http://scholar.google.co.in. You will say, what is the difference between these two? See, Google catches anything which is available electronically in the web. So suppose if there is an advertisement from a company, this will also be taken up by Google. Anything that remains electronically anywhere in the world for a duration of time, Google will pick it up. So if Google picks it up, what is the problem? Problem is, if I'm doing a literature search using Google, so a lot of company advertisement, lot of shop advertisement, lot of XYZ thing, which I do not want to search as a scholar will be coming. So I'm interested only in scholarly literature. So when you want to search for scholarly literature, you just search Google Scholar, and this will give you scholarly literature. It will give you peer-reviewed paper. It will give you thesis, but PubMed will not give you thesis. PubMed only lists those journals which are having indexed or which are indexed. But in addition, PubMed has taken it after sufficient review about regularity of its publication, about this place of origin of this publication, about the conflict of interest of this publication, about the quality of this publication, and so on. But Google Scholar will take thesis, it takes books, it takes abstract, it takes professional society uploads, it takes preprint repositories, it takes universities and other scholarly organizations. So therefore, what you get in PubMed is very filtered thing. What you get is in Google is the most unfiltered thing, and what you get in Google Scholar is in between. Now look at this. I have done a Google Scholar search here, and I have given cryptosporidium and transplant recipient, and I got a lot of scholarly thing there. Now, what is the extra advantage of Google Scholar over PubMed? Because PubMed is so good, give selected things, why should I at all go to Google Scholar? The reason is, many a time when you have published, you want to know whether you have been cited. Because if we publish something which is not cited, it is worth not publishing. It is worth introspecting yourself. Are you doing some quality work? Because people are not citing you. People are not bothering to talk about you. So look at this. I've done a Google Scholar search here, and it says in the bottom, cited by 11 papers or 11 authors. And if I click here, I can even know who are the author, which are the journal, who cited me. So this is to track somebody, some author's performance about citation. In addition, it obviously gives the title, it gives related article, it gives library link, forget about that. I'm interested in Google Scholar that whether my paper has been cited or not, because many a time you apply for anything, they want that you have published extensively, I know, but I want to know, are you cited enough? So I need to know my citation. Also, another advantage is Google, when you are preparing a presentation, you need to actually get a lot of image, and all the time clicking image and here and there and making your own repository is like trying to rediscover the wheel. So therefore it becomes difficult. So in Google, you write whatever you want and click on image in the top menu bar, and it will give a lot of images which are available in the web. But remember one thing, when you use that, be careful. Never use those in your published article, because most of them are copyrighted. So therefore, if you publish those in your article, like even a review article, you are subject to litigation. There can be compensation asked for from you. It is like plagiarism. It is doing plagiarism of the images. So therefore, what happens is, also many professional societies which are of really good standard, they say if you are putting an image, it should not be a copyrighted image. It should be your own image, or it should be an image where you have taken from some source but took permission from that source. Okay, but many a time I use this image to make my idea, to make a drawing, and then make an original drawing before I publish something. Now this is Scopus. Scopus is a paid system. So Scopus is a paid system. Scopus is a very good search engine, but it is a paid system. But many of the journals, at least in gastroenterology, I'm sure it would be same in other field. When you do a peer review, you really give people time. you give the journal time and do not get any reward. So therefore, many journal has a system that if you are peer reviewed for them, they give you a reward, giving 3 month Scopus subscription free of cost. So I'll show you what I do with Scopus. Look at this. Scopus is one of the best way to look at what is your citation, because I can track my citation like this before 2000, 2006, 2007, 2008, and so on. Obviously, this search was done quite a long time ago. Therefore, this is only listing up to 2008, and you get year by year your number of citation. Also, all the articles that you have produced, it is like you assess your students to know that whether the student is good or average. Similarly, you assess your articles, whether you have published something worth publishing or not. Because if I find an article has been extensively cited, I know this is an area which I should work. I should imitate this sort of publication. Now, what is H index? H index is an author level matrix. H index is an author level matrix. I'll not go to the mathematics of the matrix because it will make you make things cumbersome. This was innovated or developed by a fellow whose name is George E. Hirst in 2005. So that means quite some time ago, about 15 years ago. And what is this H index? The H index, let us say, look at my H index. So what I have done is in the Google Scholar, I have put my name. After putting my name, I have clicked and it shows me total publication. It shows how many paper I have published. It shows how many times they have been cited. It says 10,767 times. It says in last 5 years, how many times cited? This is 6,090. This is called citation applied. So that means if you produce a paper and it is being cited beyond 5 years, that means your citation applied is reasonable. If it is not being cited beyond 5 years, that also you can check from here. Look at H index. H index says around 56. So what is H index? H index is the number of indented to represent both the productivity and impact of a particular scientist. So it says that how much you are producing and what is your impact. Impact means it is based on citation, and productivity is the based on number of paper published. So based on number of paper published and based on citation, the product of these two is H index, okay? Now it says, let us say H index of somebody is, let us say 55. What does it mean? 55 means that at least 10 papers, 55 papers have been cited more than 55 times. So 55 papers have been cited 55 times. So if I produce 300 paper, only 55 of my papers were cited more than 55 times. That is H index. What is the I-10 index? I-10 index is 10 stands for citation. 10 stands for citation here. So that means it tells me that of all the paper that I produce, 211 paper were cited more than 10 times. So 211 paper were cited more than 10 times. Also, literature search is important to say, are you missing something? Like, let us say you wrote a paper. You wrote a paper. And after writing the paper, you are not very careful to see whether you are missing something or not. What is missing something? Look at this. This is one of the journal page in which I'm the editor. And if you look at the left side of this, in a small red writing, it gives me that how much is the copying or similarity with another paper. So the moment the editor sees a paper, the journal has an inbuilt system most good journal have. This system is called iThenticate. For iThenticate is a company. They have to pay to this company. What iThenticate does is all the electronic or scientific scholarly paper available in the world, they actually have their database linked to their system. So what happens is it start matching the database, seeing that did this author actually copy somebody else's language. Now here, the editor in one glance see that one paper copying has been maybe 15%. In another paper, copying has been maybe 22%. And in another paper, copying maybe at to the tune of 40% or more. I can't read it very well. So we can see that this paper, which is 15%, is a reasonable paper, obviously. And these paper are not reasonable paper. So if the author searched the electronic database very well, he could have also made out that I'm tending to copy, or maybe the reverse is true. Maybe he has searched extensively, but used things wrongly. He has copied from other literature. So you are trying to hide something. What are you trying to hide? You are trying to hide that you have read papers before, you have used it wrongly, you have copied their sentences, and then you think editor will not be able to pick up. It is not possible that an editor has read everything in the world. You are absolutely wrong, because this is already inbuilt in the system. And this we called as plagiarism. And plagiarism, truly speaking, is a punishable offense in the academic world. Now, you want to again know through search engine, like I was talking about author. An author is performing, whether his I-10 index is good or not good, whether his H index is good or not good. Similarly, the journal also uses literature search to know whether their journal impact is good or not good. So that is called impact factor. What is impact factor? Impact factor is, let us say, if there is a journal in 1 year, let us say 2018, these journals has published 100 articles. 2018, these journals has published 100 articles. Now in the subsequent 2 years, if these articles are cited by other authors, let us say 2,000 times. So the impact factor of the journal is 2,000 divided by 100 is equal to 20. So that is also obviously done through the literature search. And people think that higher impact journal are better journal. Okay. Now I'll skip this, but maybe if some people are interested, let me tell you. Open access journal, like when I was doing a literature search, you find that some of the papers are open access. Some of the papers are open access. Open access means you click and immediately it opens. In open access journal, often authors have paid the fees for publication. Sometimes the society which is publishing this journal might have paid the fees, and the fees is not small. It is from $2,000 to $3,000. Now, those journals which are open access often tend to have a better citation than those which are not open access. And this is called Futon bias. Futon is full text on the net bias. Now, there are other search engines. These are also very important. One of them is Cochrane Library. So Cochrane Library, what they do is they actually invite people of standing and those who are interested to do meta-analysis and systematic review and meta-analysis for them. Now then, once systematic review and meta-analysis is done, if this is of sufficient quality, they publish it. Often they help the author in doing some literature search. They may give access to some of the literature which are not open access. They may give other sort of support with expertise. And then they publish this material. They keep it open access so that broadly all the scientists can be benefited. So this is a very good search engine for your literature search. And in fact, if you read one Cochrane review, let us say published today, you can be reasonably sure that most of the work which are important that in that field have been cited in this Cochrane review. So therefore, it is good to supplement your own literature search using any search engine by a systematic review if it is available in Cochrane recently published. That is very important. Okay. Now, there are ample number of other search engines. Obviously, we are not going to, just wait 1 minute. Hello, sir. Yes, sir. Now what happens is there are ample number other search engine. In fact, many of their publisher have their own search engine. For example, look at here, SpringerLink. Springer now has sort of blended with Nature. So Nature is a publishing house. Springer is a publishing house. They blended with each other. And then what happens is the Springer Nature, they publish huge number of journals, books, and other scholarly content, and this is a search engine. So they show it as a search engine. Similarly, look at this, I've listed here, Sage Publication. This is again another publishing house. Thomson Reuters is the company which gives actually the impact factor for the journal, and they also provide you search engine. So there are a lot of such search engines available. Now this is another search engine. EndNote. So EndNote is what? When you use references, often you use an electronic technology to put the references. So these electronic technologies, several are available. For example, Reference Manager, for example, EndNote. There are also some which are free of cost. Now what happens is this EndNote helps to produce you a library. From the library itself, you can cite into the word directly without any, not without much effort, without much effort. But what happens is in the same library, I can go to tool and then I can say search reference. Then I can put here author name. I can put here journal name or whatever. I can put here keyword and click on the search and produce the library directly from the literature if my computer having EndNote has an internet connection. So therefore, many of these which are actually referencing engine, they are the one which help the author to refer to or create the reference section in their article. Even there, to make the things convenient, they have actually produced a search engine. And typically, whatever search engine you want to connect, let us say you want to do a PubMed search through EndNote, just you connect to PMID. So you open EndNote, then you say search, it will ask which search engine you want to use for searching. You say, I want to search PubMed. So click on PubMed, then EndNote will do search in PubMed and then produce the library, and you can save that library. So I thought this is a brief introduction to the literature search. So now, obviously, I tried to really keep it brief. I tried to keep it quite inclusive rather than exclusive to one particular search engine. Also, I did not enter into too much technical detail because coordinator told me that there are other experts who are going to demonstrate you the technical detail. Now, if you have any question, I'll really like to answer.
Sir.
Yes.
So my question is whether there is any particular search engine which is the better over others, which is the best one, if I choose one search engine to use.
You see, what happens is, I don't think you can call anything as best or anything as worst. But if you say Google is the one which produces most redundant search. So Google is the one which produces most redundant searches or searches having most redundant material. Whereas if you look at the Scopus and all, they're quite restrictive, okay? They're quite restrictive. Similarly, PubMed is quite restrictive. Like you can name several journals which are being published for many years, but still they are not in PubMed. Also, PubMed periodically removes the journal from their search engine if they find that journal is not really wholesome, is quite regional or local, even not regional, local. The content is not good. Regularity of publication is not good. Peer review process is not good. They don't follow blinded peer review system. Rejection rate is poor. Citation is poor. They remove it. So what I'm saying is that's why when you do a PubMed search, you get a very restrictive material, but it is like you are getting the most filtered material. Whereas if you want a redundant search, so then you go to Google. Many a time it is good to use both. The reason I will tell you, many a time because of the restriction, some of the things you may not get in PubMed, particularly which are not indexed in PubMed, but those things you can get in Google. One more thing I'll tell you here, since you asked this question, when you do a systematic review, today there is a guideline which says you should use more than two search engines, maybe three is better. So why do they say that? That basically all the systematic review, the editor want your systematic review should be very thorough, very comprehensive. To make it comprehensive, they want actually three search engines. And in these three search engines, they stress not on Google, because Google produces a lot of redundant search. They say that you can use PubMed, you can use Corpus, you can use Embase, and so on. So what I'm saying is that basically tells you maybe they rely more on PubMed, Embase, and Scopus rather than Google. So if I go by them, then I would say these are the three good ones. Any other question?
Good evening, sir. Thank you for the inspiring presentation. This Zotero and EndNote, do they have the same function, sir, when we use them, when you're coming to bibliographic citation?
You see, I do not use Zotero. Is the Zotero one which gives you free? Am I right?
Yes, sir. Zotero.
Yeah, free. I did use Zotero. So what happens is I use EndNote. But what I'm saying is I find the EndNote is very comprehensive. It is reasonably simple. I can use even my own library, uploading all the PDFs into the EndNote. So I do not know about Zotero because I have not used it. But what happens is, are you comfortable with Zotero?
Yes, sir. I've used previously and I was.
Does it create error? Like, let us say in EndNote, if I produce a paper, now I send to X journal. X journal rejected that paper. Now I want to go to Y journal. And the Y journal has a different style of reference. Now I put one click, and it will convert the whole of the reference section according to Y journal. Does Zotero do that?
Yes, sir. Zotero also has the same option. We can now convert between.
I don't know because I have not used both. I am not the best person to compare between these two. But what I am saying is you have to see that the number of journals that EndNote gives, journal style that EndNote gives is phenomenal, maybe compared to Zotero. Because that is where there could be a difference. Number of journal style that EndNote gives is phenomenal, maybe compared to Zotero. You will tell me how many Zotero gives, but I know EndNote is phenomenal. It is not only medical journal, it gives engineering journal, it gives general science journal, it gives even others type of journal which have nothing to do with medical science. So that is one where maybe EndNote may score over Zotero, but I have to experience, right. I have to get my experience with Zotero.
Right.